We've got some time restrictions this morning, so we're going to allow our candidates for National Committeewoman to come up and speak to you. So we've got Maria Zack, Ginger Howard, and Linda Umberger. If you guys would come up here real quick, please. All right, now, for those of you who may not have previously been involved, the National Committeewoman position is a position from the Georgia GOP, come on up, Linda, from the Georgia GOP, who represent us at the national level with the RNC. I'm going to let these ladies tell you about what they do, 5 to 10 minutes, yeah, roughly, however long you need. And I think a good number of the people in this room are delegates or alternates, so hopefully you'll have some, you'll be able to win some votes here today. So first up, we'll have Maria Zack.
Thank you, Rick. For those of you who don't know me, I am Maria Zack. Used to be Maria Strollo till I met the love of my life, Steve, that many of you know and also love, and know that Steve is as passionate as I am and got involved in the Cherokee GOP for years. We were very instrumental in fundraising for the party, and it was great news to hear from Rick today that he has been a good steward of the money, because I could be out there raising the money for y'all and helping build the party and building the troops and getting candidates to run. And I love doing that. But you always have these moments where you go, oh my gosh, I hope that they actually were good stewards of the money. And I hope that the person that I recruited to run does what they said they were gonna do. And that's kind of why I'm running for the RNC. How many here are happy with the job of the RNC? Come on, don't be shy. How many of you are happy with the job of the RNC? Nope. All right, that is why I'm running. We must restore trust in the RNC. We must restore trust in our elected officials. We must get back on track on messaging. So I have a real simple plan. Legislate, communicate, educate. Now, I love our platform, but our platform doesn't always become the policy we want. I have 30 years of experience. I've helped run over 50 races. I've raised millions of dollars for the Republican Party, for the caucuses, helping out with individual races. I can tell you that I'm not always happy with the result. And when it comes to our platform and taking policy, that is something that I have had 30 years of expertise in taking policy and actually turning it into legislation. We need to stop a second and focus on why we are failing the American public, why people are angry. They have every right to be. Wasteful spending should not be tolerated. Today's world, we have to move a lot faster. So did y'all get my email? Those who are delegates and alternates, if you did not get my email, please email me. We have sheets that we'll be passing out. Please email me and I will send you the bulleted plan. It's very extensive. And I want to let you know there's a lot that has to be done, and it has to be done fast. The American public is very distrustful, and they have the right to be. And we have to regain that trust. And in order to regain the trust, we have to do what we say we're going to do. So I built out a plan on the legislative side to make sure that we have the collaboration, because we have to remember, when candidates run on the Republican ticket, it's we who allowed them to run on our party ticket. So they must honor that, and we have to hold them accountable. And there are ways to do that. So I gave an extensive plan out about 2 weeks ago. I'm happy to re-email it for anyone who didn't get it. And I want to say this, you know, I know for Cherokee, all of y'all have been a family to me. You saw me get married, and y'all came and actually set up everything for the wedding, and you guys have just been a family, and seeing Patty Baker here is phenomenal. You know, when we went and recruited candidates in Cherokee, we still were fighting the Democrats. And same at the state party level, serving on the executive committee, we were in the minority. Didn't have any of the congressional offices. We didn't have any of the constitutional offices. We regained and took all the constitutional offices, all of the, both the Senate and the House. We have taken over at the state level, and we must stop the Democrats on every effort that they make in DeKalb, Fulton, and elsewhere to come up. Forsyth County's starting to see some movement in South Forsyth, so we're working on plans to stop that. But Patty Baker's a good example, Chip Rogers, where we went and we recruited the candidates, we got them to run. She's been a phenomenal candidate, but she also was someone who went in and did what she said she was gonna do. So it's not a situation where you had to hold your nose. You're grateful because she is the public servant of what you tried to get. And so I can remember we had to turn around a direct mail piece. We were just reminiscing. 24 hours, she got slammed with just false statements. And we turned around and did a mailer and had it out the door in under 24 hours. Yeah, we were up till 2, 3, 4 in the morning, but that's what it takes. So being able to communicate, you got to get your message out. And the RNC has to get better at explaining to the Republican Party that, and to Americans, the Republican Party is the heart and soul of America. Don't you guys agree? American values are the Republican Party. So we must stand firm on that. So I'm asking y'all, join me. It's gonna take an army. It's not gonna be me up there going to Washington and trying to convince everybody to do something. We're gonna invoke group meetings, committees. We're gonna build, because this is so important. Our country is hanging by a thread. And for those of you who don't know, and Bob can tell you, when my house was flooded and destroyed during the first Tea Party thing with Jenny Beth and Linda, we were all at the US Capitol helping run the Tea Party, and the GOP came and helped save everything they could out of my house. We rebuild, and we discover that we have terrorists living across the street that are funding Al-Qaeda and ISIS. It is not a happy day when you live in Town Lake Hills East and you get a mailer from the FBI and Atlanta Police Department. You have to say, I don't live in Atlanta. Why is the Atlanta Police Department contacting me? A frightening time to discover that there are tunnels under their home and they could not find the guy, and they finally sent the dogs in and found the hidden tunnels. Did anyone hear about that on the news? No. So I want to tell y'all, I have been in briefings across the country. The past 2 years have been amazing. I've been running a super PAC. I've been in briefings that would just shock you. And it is time for you to be better informed. When I'm with Ron Lauder's chief executive of their organization, everyone know Estee Lauder, her son Ron, he's the world leader of a group to protect Israel. And the meetings I've been in have shown that there are 3 jihad camps now in Georgia, not 2. So I want to impress upon y'all that it is time. There is a sense of urgency. We must move fast. We must send people who know what is happening and have a plan to change it. And that is why I'm running for the RNC. I love you guys. It's great to be back. Please, please, please stay in touch with me. Let's work hard, and I ask for your vote for National Committeewoman. Thank you, and God bless. I'm off to another county, so I love you. Please talk to Bob. Let's see, Patty. I know Conrad's here, so my team's all throughout, so please don't hesitate to ask any questions you may have. Thank you. God bless you.
Thanks, Maria. All right. If I could ask everybody, I know it's we all want to chat with each other, but I really would like for everybody to be able to hear the speaker, so if you could please keep the conversation down to a minimum, I would appreciate it. And next I'm going to ask Linda Umberger to come up and speak to us. So, Linda?
Thank you. It is a privilege to be here. I live in Dawson County, which isn't too far away, and enjoy the drive over and love coming in and seeing the flags and everything as I came down Main Street crossing over the highway. And y'all are great. I mean, the turnout here is phenomenal, and I congratulate you for getting up on a rainy morning, being active, and being part, and being what is the Republican Party. I had an experience in November of 1976 where my dad woke me up and said, get dressed, there's something important going on. We did not vote for Jimmy Carter, but this is a historic moment as a Georgian. That the first Georgian has just been elected President of the United States. And while I was there and listening and standing in the crowd, it became apparent to me that whatever party these people were, I was not. And that was my moment of conversion to become a Republican. And ever since then, and because of my parents and the values they instilled in me, I have been a Republican. And what does that mean? It means that I respect the Constitution, I respect life, I'm for limited government, and I'm for personal responsibility. And when we look at where we are as a nation, all that is being lost. And when I continue with my life and what the Lord has blessed me with, that I had the opportunity to work in the Reagan White House and intern, and then go on to be a mom of what I consider to be the most four greatest kids in the world. And I got to homeschool them. And what I see going on is that our economy, restrictions, government regulations, Obamacare, the cost of everything, are preventing parents from being able to impact the lives of their children. Why? Because they are so busy working just to pay the light bill, just to pay insurance. Oh, and that cell phone bill, which is kind of expensive. But anyway, moving right along. When you look at what's at stake and the role of the RNC, and yes, I do want to congratulate the RNC, because under Reince Priebus, first quarter, they had a record-breaking fundraising, even in a presidential race, which is good because we need this money going into November. Because I don't know about you, but there is no doubt in my mind that we cannot have Hillary Clinton as a president. Because when you look at bathrooms, when you look at our religious liberties, when you look at everything, all that will be lost under President Clinton. And the fact that on September 11th of 2012, the current administration and Hillary Clinton allowed our ambassador and our servicemen to totally be abandoned by our nation. There should be no doubt in anyone's mind here today that you need to vote, and you need to vote for the Republican nominee who it looks like it's going to be Donald Trump, and you need to do that enthusiastically. And I'd also like to share with you, I'm very excited that we've been able to get Tig, who is one of the authors of 13 Hours, and he will be at the convention on Friday, June 3rd, signing books and speaking, and we'll also be having a viewing of 13 Hours, so I'd like to invite you to come and see that and meet him and to share with your friends and family that at the end of the day, that moment on September 11th, 2012 is real, crystal clear. There is no doubt of who they need to be voting for this November. Which, when you look at what is the point of the RNC, the point of the RNC is that it is made up of three members from each state and each territory, making 168 members. Those 168 members help with fundraising, they help with the budget, they do rules, they do resolutions, and they also do site. So a lot of the things that are done as RNC members are very limited, but it's about amplifying. It's about getting Georgia to be the leader at the RNC and taking our Georgia values to the RNC to have impact. To have impact on what goes on at the national level. We are very blessed. Randy Evans has done a great job on the Rules Committee. Most people on the Rules Committee are attorneys. Linda Herron, who is our current National Committee Woman, has done a great job on the Budget Committee. I would like to continue with what she has established on the Budget Committee, because it's been my experience, usually whoever controls the purse strings and whoever is making decisions where the money's going has a lot of input. And when we look at what Maria pointed out, where the money's going, we need to do a better job messaging, we need to do a better job training young people, and oh, the most important thing, we need to do a better job coming to you all on the grassroots and saying, what do you need to be successful? I had the privilege of working on two presidential candidates' teams this cycle, and it was fascinating to me how different they were. One team came to me and said, Linda, what do you need to be successful? You know this area in South Carolina, what is it going to take? And it was that sort of attitude that made such a powerful difference. because it's not someone up here saying, based on the data, you need to do this. You know your community. The RNC and some very intelligent geek sitting in an office does not know it like you do. So what do you need? How can we help you to level, to, you know, uplift and utilize your network to turn out the vote? What do you need? So it's all about you. How do we get your voice heard? How do we get you empowered to do what you need to do to turn out the vote and turn our country around and bring it back to our values and what we value to hold on to it for our kids? I encourage you to go to lynda2016.gop, learn more about what we're doing, and join Team Lynda. I'd love to have you. I ask for your vote. Also, some of you will have gotten in the mail this thing about Get Connected. It's a great new app that we're experimenting with because calling people on their landlines to go vote really isn't that effective. It's kind of annoying. So what about using their cell phones to connect with them? So I encourage you to go to your app store, download Blue Arc, and on Tuesday, when you go by your precinct, you'll probably get a message reminding you to vote with the hours of when the precinct is open and things like that. And it's just another avenue to increase voter contact that we're experimenting with. So thank you very much and keep up your great work.
I would please like to remind you again to try to keep the noise to a minimum. We do want everybody to be able to hear these folks. Please keep it down. And I'd like to ask Ginger Howard to come up and address the crowd, please. Once again, please keep the noise down.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me. Good morning. How are you? I am from South Georgia. I'm from a little town called Waycross, Georgia, but I moved to the big city after I graduated from University of Georgia, and I moved to Washington, D.C. on a dare right out of college because I was such not a risk taker back then. Right now, I'll take any risk you can imagine, but back then, when I was a little girl, I wouldn't even spend the night out because I was homesick. So some friends dared me one day that I would never move, and I said, oh, I'll move, and they said, where are you going to move? I said, oh, let me pick. I'll move to Washington, D.C. I literally moved to Washington, D.C. on a dare. I did not have a job. I did not have a place to live. And my car broke down on the way up there. So I thought, uh-oh. But it all turned out great. And I moved when George H.W. Bush got elected the first time. Well, the only time. But that was such an exciting time. And I really got a bug for politics. And that was when Lee Atwater was chair of the RNC. And you all, if you've been around for a while, you remember what an amazing chairman he was. And I wanted to work so badly on the Hill, but I went to Georgia and I majored in fashion merchandising. That is my background. I have a small business. I have a clothing store in Atlanta. But I didn't want to work in fashion. I wanted to work on the Hill. I had no experience. All I had ever done was selling clothes. But I knocked on every door on the Hill. I want to work for you. Nobody would hire me. But I had a friend who worked at the RNC, and they graciously said, well, you can work on the phone banks. So I started working part-time on the phone banks. My main job was a manager of a beautiful clothing store in Alexandria, but they gave everybody a script to use, except I didn't use the script. And all of a sudden, the money started going up and up and up, and they'd come over and listen to me. I was not using my script, and people were saying, honey, I'll give you whatever amount of money you want if you'll just keep talking with that accent. So they'd let me call the North and the Midwest, and I raised a lot of money for the RNC. That was my first bug in politics. And those of you that are here, you know, once you get the political bug, it never leaves you. But the thing is, the thing that drove me to Washington was the thing that drove me away. And I got homesick and I moved back, but I never got out of that love for politics. So I moved to Atlanta, Georgia 20 years ago, and I got involved in the grassroots. I started working on Saxby Chambliss's campaign, and I just really, really got involved, and I loved it. And I have been an entrepreneur for 23 years, and I have a heart for this country. And the Republican National Committee, their main mission is to provide national leadership for the Republican Party. So I have reflected on the kind of leader that I would like to be. And I've come up with three leaders that I have watched in my lifetime. and I want to emulate some of their characteristics. And the first one is Ronald Reagan. And one of the things that I love about Ronald Reagan, there's so many things we love about Ronald Reagan, but one of the greatest things I love about him is that he was called the Great Communicator. And in his farewell speech, he said, "You know, I really wasn't the great communicator. I just communicated great things. And I want to communicate great things to you today, that we have a hope, we have a future, we have a wonderful country, and our best days are not behind us, they're ahead of us. And if we all unite and we lock arms, and if you were for Ted Cruz, or you were for John Kasich, or you were for Donald Trump, or you were for Rick Perry like me, you lock arms with your fellow Republican, your fellow conservative, and you say, we want to take this country back. We have hope, we believe, we can do it if we all unite. Let's all say that you're 80% friend is not your 20% enemy. For heaven's sakes, everyone in this room doesn't want Hillary Clinton to be elected, so guess what? We're 100% unanimous on that. So that's my number one leader that I want to emulate. And number two, my second leader that I love is George W. Bush. And one of the things I love is he had a servant's heart. And many of you don't even know the things, I don't even know the things he's done behind the scenes for our military. He, remember the time that he flew to Iraq? When it was very dangerous for him to go, he left his family on Thanksgiving, and I'm in my kitchen at my mother's house, and I look up, and there's George Bush serving turkey to the soldiers in Iraq, and I just started crying. He left his family. His advisor said, "Don't go, this is not safe." But he said, "They are making a sacrifice for me. How can I not go?" And when he was a little boy, his mother taught him the proverb, "Let another praise you and not your own lips." And that's another thing I want to be. I want to be a servant leader who does not toot my own horn. I want to just do the work that he, like George Bush did. And my number three leader is Rick Perry. I had the privilege of serving short term on his campaign for president this past time. I was his state chair. But he had a slogan that said, "Show me, don't tell me." And he did that in Texas. He would tell you something, but he would do it. And so many people, and that is why we're so frustrated now. That is why Donald Trump has resonated with so many people. So many politicians run on a platform and they tell you something and it sounds so wonderful and we all jump on their bandwagon, but then they get there and they don't do what they said they're gonna do. I wanna be a woman of my word. There's a psalm that's one of my favorite verses. It says, "You keep your oath even when it hurts." And sometimes it hurts. It's hard to make those decisions. And the main thing of a committee woman is to vote, and to vote rightly. And I want to vote to keep our platform, God in our country, religious liberty, sanctity of life, marriage between a man and a woman. The fact that we would even have to discuss that now in our nation. Our forefathers pledged their lives, their fortune, and their sacred honor to stand for religious liberty. I want to stand for you. My tagline for my election is Georgia's conservative voice to the RNC. You all have so many voices. I have been all over the state since January the 5th, and I want to tell you, I want to synthesize all that you've been telling me and be that one voice to the RNC. So if you're a delegate or an alternate on June 4th, I would love your vote. GingerHoward.net, Ginger for Georgia. Thank you and God bless you.